Morning, everyone, or good afternoon, or good evening, wherever you are. So it's a great pleasure to welcome everyone to the second Aisenstadt lecture by Professor Niziol. So she will talk about arithmetic computations in this lecture.
Okay, thank you. So I want to continue my lectures on the cohomologies of p-adic symmetric spaces. And today I wanted to do some arithmetic examples. So I have two, prepared two. We have the coverings of Drinfeld half plane, so dimension one. And we have Drinfeld symmetric space in any dimension. So I will start with the dimension one. Okay, so we are looking at the upper half plane. So here I am assuming for the moment that K is a finite extension of QP. Later we will specialize to just QP. So we have a projective space and we extract the K rational points. H sub C will be the base change to the completion of the algebraic closure of K of H. We have a group G acting on it, which is the GL2 of K, and we have Galois group acting on it. So recall that I mentioned that etale cohomology of the geometric etale cohomology with QP coefficients twisted by one. It's a dual of, I wrote here the continuous Steinberg, but you, if you like just to think of smooth Steinberg, you can also, then it would be smooth Steinberg with values in ZP and QP will be outside. So the proof is by Colmez theory, and you use properties of the Picard group, vanishing of the Picard groups of the standard affinoid covering, which comes from, so recall how you have the standard semi-stable model, integral model of the half plane. And if you choose the central component, then you can look at all the components in distance n of your central component. And they are going to intersect with the remaining components. So if you extract these intersection points, you have an open set of the special fiber. And if you look at the tube associated to that, you get an affinoid on the generic fiber, and that's the nth affinoid of the Stein covering, more or less. Okay, so two remarks I want to make here is that, well, first of all, this cohomology looks like something, well, maybe big, but something reasonable, something familiar from other places. What is misleading here is that this is rather small in the sense that, so I wrote here, formally speaking, it's coadmissible, but if you don't want to wonder what coadmissible is, just think of this as measures. This is actually some quotient of measures, as I will explain later on. And this fails if you go in the Drinfeld tower. Okay, so unfortunately, I will need quite a bit of notation. So I will start with the description of the tower. So we have G check is the invertible elements in quaternions D. OD will be maximal order and uniformizer will be pi D. And I describe here the Drinfeld tower. There will be a lot of, in this talk, there will be a lot of technicalities which I will sweep under the rug and kind of starting at this point. So just to make the exposition maybe a bit more transparent. So this is the Drinfeld tower. So at the very bottom, we have the half plane we started with, but then we extended to K Breve, which is the field of fractions of the vid vectors of the algebraic closure of the residue field. And then we cross it with Z. So we take Z copies of the half plane extended to K Breve. Then we look at this, so Drinfeld define a whole system of covers, finite etale covers, Mn. And this check here just means because the base is Breve, we will get rid of it in a moment. And then we have M infinity, which we just think formally as the limit of this covers. So we don't really put any structure on it. Then we are lucky here because on every level, if you look on every level, then you have an action of the original group, the GL2, you have action of the quaternions, but you also have an action of the Weyl group coming from the extension, Weyl group of K. Then the Galois, the transformation group here is equal to the units in OD and divided by this level 1 plus pi n OD. And one more thing I want to mention is that here the Frobenius transforms, shifts by one the components. Otherwise it acts by on the coefficients k Bredel. Okay, so as I said, we look at this M infinity in a completely naive way. First of all, we are interested in the geometric structure, so we extend everything to C, and then we look at cohomologies of M infinity, which for us would be just limit of cohomologies on finite levels. So we don't really put any special structure at infinity. Okay, so our main theorem. So in few words, we are saying that we can recover the p-adic Langlands correspondence in this Drinfeld tower for a subset of representations. So this will be the RAM representations of dimension 2 with Hodge weights 0, 1 and with irreducible Weyl-Dehlin representation. So I will explain all of these words in a moment, but let me state the precise theorem. So we are going to study representations with coefficients in some finite extension L of QP. So we look at such representations of the Galois group. We are assuming they are absolutely irreducible. And here for now, I will take any dimension greater than 2. So the first statement says if V is supercuspidal, and I will explain what that means, dimension exactly 2 and Hodge weight 0, 1. Then if you look at the V part of etale cohomology, so everywhere we have this L extension, unfortunately we need to keep track of it. If we look at the V part of the cohomology, V part in the sense of homes compatible with the action of the Weyl group, here we get the multiplicity is now equal to the Jacques Langlands representation associated to V. And here the dual of the pi v, which is the representation associated to v by the p-adic local Langlands. So I will explain on next page all of these terms and also some basic properties. The second claim says that if you look at other representations, so for example, not supercuspidal, but also of higher dimension than 2, then the same V part of a etale cohomology is in fact 0. So there's no multiplicities, there is no morphism. Okay. So I want to recall, so this is the p-adic story. I want to recall that in the lattice setting, so L not different than P, then of course these kind of theorems are now in great generality due to general proofs due to Harris, Taylor, and Enyar, and in our case, in dimension 1, to Carayol-Dehlin. Okay, so let's look at the meaning of these multiplicities here, and maybe what do I mean by supercuspidal representation. Okay, so we start with the RAM representation, L coefficients again, dimension 2 and Hodge weight 0, 1. Okay, so now to such a representation, Fontaine associates the Dudonne module DPST is going to be rank 2 and over this funny object here, because again, we extended the coefficients to L. And phi n module has phi action, monodromy action, but also some residual action of the Galois group. Okay, and now we can associate to such a DPST, we can associate Weyl-Dehlin representation. Basically, we have all the data already here to construct Weyl-Dehlin representation. For technical reasons, we put the twist here. So there is Frobenius twisted by P and representation by some character. Okay, now LLV will denote the local Langlands representation associated to this Weyl-Dehlin representation of G. So it's a smooth irreducible infinite dimensional representation. Now, Jacques Langlands now will associate to this local Langlands representation, the representation we call GLV. It's important, it's a finite rank representation, and it's a representation of the dual group. And then we have the continuous unitary representation, which comes from p-adic local Langlands associated to V, which we call pi capital pi V. So this is a representation of G. Now remarks, so the Veldelin representation, of course, depends only on the DPST, then, but also local Langlands and Jacques Langlands, which depends on local Langlands again, all of them depend only on the DPST structure. So recall that to pass from V to this the RAM data, you need the DPST, but you also need actually some filtration, and this filtration is missing here, so that the RAM Dudonne module is missing from this story. So if we add it back, then we have dependence on V, and this is needed for, and the pi V depends really on all of these structures now. Okay, and then we have a theorem that classical local Langlands can be recovered from this p-adic local Langlands by taking the smooth vectors. Smooth vectors means that the orbits are smooth of elements. And now what do we mean by supercuspidal representation? So that means for us that the Veldelin representation is irreducible. So recall we have the monodromy acting here. So in particular, we have that the n has to be zero on DPST. So if this was really a semi-stable model, semi-stable Dudonne module, that would mean that the representation is crystalline. We have this potentially semi-stable fellow here, so it's potentially crystalline. And that in particular also implies that the local Langlands representation is supercuspidal. Okay, so this is our terminology here for this theorem. I need more notation for the proof actually. So we will need these constructions here. So let's start with the phi n g modules, DPST associated to some representation, but let's start with any one. Supercuspidal just means that the is associated to supercuspidal representation. So Veldelin is reducible. Then we extend it to M check. So we extend it to the Breve, QP Breve. And then the MDR part is the associated RAM Dudonne module, which is obtained by this formula. So you normally you would just extend to QP bar, but you have to take the GK vectors, fixed vectors to descend down to some finite level. So we get free module of rank 2 over this funny object here, K tensor L again. Okay, now once I have M and MDR, Fontaine tells us that we should be able to construct representation by putting filtration on this MDR. We are in dimension 2, so filtration just means a choice of a line. So we have a line here, L line, we want to keep these same coefficients. And then by Fontaine, we get this functor, which to our MM and MDR filtered by L, associates now a representation of the Galois group. So we are in weight 0, 1, so Bideram plus it becomes just C here. So this is just Fontaine functor. And finally, I'm going to simplify my notation in what follows. And by taking M part for a Dudonne module M, for a representation of G check, the dual group, I will just, I mean by M part, I mean the homomorphisms, G check equivariant from the Jacques Langlands representation associated to M, which means the Jacques Langlands representation associated to actually the Galois representation or by the linear representation associated to M. And then I have here T, but I also want to put L here, so I will be able to get all this L for all the story to large degree. So this is important to remember that the M part just means Jacques Langlands M part, so to speak. Okay, so I got all the main actors here on this, and now let's pass to the proof. So the theorem, let's maybe go to the theorem back. So the theorem has two claims. In the first claim, we claim that the multiplicities in this dimension 2 case are of this form. So they are the way you would like them to be. And then everywhere else we get zero. So the second claim, the proof is very tricky. And we tried to conceptualize it so that we can actually present it in talk. We tried it twice and it just didn't work. So I'm going to skip that proof. But I want to point out that we struggled with it because conceptually, because we tried to prove something opposite. We tried to prove that there is in fact a lot here of V's inside this H1 etale. And the reason for our belief that it might be the case was because this is exactly what happens on the Lubin-Tate side. So at the bottom of Lubin-Tate side, you have a ball, open ball. And as I shown yesterday, the cohomology contains a C, so CP in our case, actually. And if your representations are non-supercuspidal or have in higher dimensions, just have weight zero, in fact, then we are still assuming they're the rank, for example, then they're in particular Hodge state, so they're going to have a non-trivial morphism to C, and you will see plenty of them. Okay, so I want to present the proof of the first claim, which computes the multiplicity. So this is the plan of the proof, the way I try to simplify it for the talk. So first, we are looking at multiplicities in etale cohomology, but I'm going to replace etale cohomology with pro-etale cohomology, which is much easier to work with. Then we are going to compute the Hodge theory fundamental diagram I was speaking about yesterday, but with concrete terms. Then I will compute something we call Broil-Strauch diagram, which follows from Broil-Strauch conjecture, which is a theorem of Dospinescu and Lebras. And then we compare these two diagrams. And when we compare these two diagrams, we get exactly the description of the M part of the proetal cohomology, which we wanted. So we will get the multiplicities, description of the multiplicities we want. Okay, so that's the plan. Okay, so passage to from etale to proetale. Okay, so what we want to get this M part and V part, so to speak, of etale cohomology as the dual of this p-adic local Langlands representation. So how can we pass to proetale instead? So we replace etale with proetale. And then we claim that we can replace now this representation with its analytic, locally analytic vectors. And the reason for that is because we proved that the proetale cohomology, when you cut it down, I mean, when you take G bounded vectors inside of it, you recover the etale cohomology. So this is what I was telling you about yesterday, that we, in these two cases we compute, we are lucky because etale cohomology sits inside proetale and can be described in this way as G-bounded vectors. And then we have a result of Colmez and Dospinescu, which tells us that in fact, if we do the same, so here, when we apply G-bounded vectors, we recover etale. But they tell us in their work that if we do the same to this side, we recover that side. So when we look at G-bounded vectors of this analytic dual of analytic, we recover the dual of the whole thing. Okay, so what do I mean by G-bounded here? I just mean that the orbits under G of elements are bounded. Okay. So now the second step is the concrete computation. So we need to make explicit the Hodge theory fundamental diagram that we were discussing yesterday. So we are in the case of a Stein curve. So these covers are Stein. In fact, so there are Stein curves. So we have the usual comparison diagram from yesterday. We have proetal cohomology. We have piece of the Deram complex downstairs, well, the whole Deram complex here, really. And we have this Hjodokato fellow, which is Hjodokato tensor BST plus and some eigenspaces. Okay, so we would like to describe this Hjodokato and Deram much more in an explicit way. So first we apply this very general theorem for any x, any Stein curve, to our M infinity. So remember the way you should think, that is, I write M infinity, but really it's an inductive limit. And because this M, when I take M part, the Jacques Langlands of M is actually finite dimensional representation, then all of this here is happening really on finite level, some level Mn. And this M infinity is just to make the notation prettier. But it's all happening on some finite level, so you can apply this diagram, and we get the following diagram. So we have pro etale and with M parts. Aha, so first we apply this diagram to M infinity, and then we take the home from Jacques Langlands of M. So we take these M parts. Then you have to argue here a little bit that everything stays exact, but this follows from the fact that G check is a compact group. And I think otherwise here we are okay. And we have here these M parts of Hodge cohomology of M infinity and the Ram cohomology of M infinity. And now we want to compute these two terms. And this is where first hard work goes into. So we prove that, and this is actually for any K finite over QP still, that we have this computation, that is the Ram part, M part of the Ram cohomology can be computed as the dual of local Langlands, terms of the M Ram, so the Dudonne module, the Ram Dudonne module. And here we get the same local Langlands part for Hodge, but the coefficients drop, and here we have the M-Breve version of this module. And this diagram should commute. So the proof, we follow actually, so in the definition of the Ram map here at the bottom was actually defined in the work of Dospinescu Lebra, and we follow that definition. So that uses for the Hodge map, that uses global methods. So we use Cheretnik-Drinfeld uniformization. We pass to some Shimura curves uniformized by some levels of the Drinfeld tower. And we appeal to the known computations in the Ladig local Langlands. Now for the surjectivity, so they worked in the assuming that K is equal QP, but one can improve on that, and then they use p-adic local Langlands, but one can improve on that by what we call the Ram flip-flopping. So you again look at the Ram cohomology on the Drinfeld side, but then you transfer it to the Lubin-Tate side. And you argue again, they're invoking the local Langlands, classical local Langlands correspondence. I don't know to which degree these arguments can be improved. We are few years after this proof, so perhaps one can write them in a better way these days. Okay, so fundamental diagram, we plug into this computation into the fundamental diagram for the Stein curves. What we get is, we get this bottom line, which is the Ram complex with the Ram cohomology replaced by local Langlands tensor that the Ram Dudonne module. And here we have local Langlands tensor, this X plus semi-stable M part of M, which is M tensor BST plus, and the eigenvalues here. So in fact, we are going to forget about this left-hand side now, because we don't really care that much about this. And if we fix now, so we need to pass to our Galois representation. So we take the line corresponding to this Galois representation, and now we take VML parts of this square on the right. So I mean, what I mean by parts, you just take homes over the Weyl group or Galois group, and you apply it to this bicartesian diagram, and we get another bicartesian diagram in this way. which in shorthand looks like this. So we have parietal cohomology, which is a pullback of after we take M and V parts, it's a pullback of diagram consisting of differentials, local Langlands and a part of Hjodokato here, and local Langlands and part of the RAM. Okay. Now we want to look at another diagram which deals with very similar objects. So this was conjectured, this diagram was conjectured by Brawl and Strach and proved by Dospinescu Lebra. And it looks very similar to the previous ones. So again, we have a bicartesian diagram here on the right. We have differentials. We have this M, the RAM, local Langlands part. Here we have L tensor C part of the tensor local Langlands. And here, this is what Dospinescu Lebra computed, is the dual of these analytic vectors of the p-adic local Langlands associated to space associated to V, and everything is tensor to C. Okay, so this is the diagram I want to remember. I take this square on the right, and I take it, again its VML part. So I have a diagram which represents this dual of locally analytic vectors, the V part of it by differentials, by this part and local Langlands, and then by this part, so L, remember, is just a line over L, so it's one dimensional object over L, and then C and local Langlands here. Okay, so let's put these two diagrams we got side by side. Okay, so okay, I don't know what happened to my, it's very strange what happened here. Okay, so I have these two diagrams put together. And so this is the diagram which comes from p-adic Hodge Theory, the top one. The bottom line comes from Broglie-Strauss conjecture. You see that the bottom lines are the same. And the top lines, well, a priori are not. So we want to prove that, in fact, the top lines are also the same. So this will give us that parietal cohomology is computed by this dual of these locally analytic vectors. And this is what we wanted to have. So in the parietal formulation of our theorem. So we compute the V part of this term here. And it turns out to be just one dimensional, just isomorphic to L. And then we compute the V part of, so that's simple enough. The computation of the V part of the term here on the right, this Hjodokato term, actually was a little bit, so we were very happy when we realized it's actually L, because for some reason, we were sure that we are going to get something two dimensional here. So so it will not fit our picture at all. And then we kept making mistakes, eventually turned out to be just one dimensional, which made us very happy. So by this computation gives us that these two terms are the same and they are equal to the dual of local Langlands. Okay, so these diagrams which say that parietal cohomology is a pullback of this diagram. And then this diagram, which says that this dual of locally analytic vectors is also pullback of these diagrams. The terms in the nodes in the diagrams are now the same. And if you can believe me that, then we can show also that the arrows are the same, then we get that these two fellows, two pullbacks are, fiber products are also the same. So this is what we wanted. We wanted that parietal cohomology is isomorphic to these locally analytic vectors. So I skipped this isomorphism here, but this basically follows from the first line, in fact, from this V part of C already. Okay, so that's the grand sketch of the ideas behind the proof of of the first claim of the multiplicities in the Drinfeld Tower. So, okay, how I'm doing with time. So this took me half an hour. So possibly I can do the other part also in half an hour. So I pass to Drinfeld symmetric spaces. So now we are in higher dimensions. So here I'm going to use comparison theorem for this, which I didn't state yet, but I will discuss it in detail tomorrow together with some arguments, but we'll just use here as a black box. So we are in higher dimensions. So again, we are in a finite extension of QP. We have a symmetric space in dimension D. So it's a projective space in dimension D, and we extract from it. And then we have an action on everything of GLD plus one K. And then classical cohomology, recall what we have. So Schneider-Stuhler proof that if we look at etale cohomology, then we get this dual of the continuous Steinbeck representation, and everything is equivariant for G and Galois action. Their method also allows, in fact, to prove, so L is not equal to P, the method allows also to prove that, in fact, it's also the case, I mean, also allows to compute the per-etale cohomology with QL coefficient, and we get the dual of the Smoof-Steinberg with QL coefficients. And also for the RAM cohomology, they compute that you get the dual of the Smoof-Steinberg with K coefficients. So I want to make a couple of remarks. So their method works for any cohomology theory which satisfies some axioms, and there are two axioms which you need, the two basic axioms you need to check if you want to apply it to any cohomology theory. One is the homotopy property with respect to the open ball of any dimension, so that this cohomology does not change when you suspend your ball, your space by this open ball. And then the projective space theorem, which tells us how the cohomology of X cross projective space looks using the cohomology of X. So you have cohomology of X shifted by the class of the hyperplane. One remark, I will talk about this later in some detail, is that we don't actually use the proof. In our proof, we don't use the argument of Schneider-Stuhler. We use a different proof which was supplied by Iovita Spies for the Deram cohomology. The reason for that is that it's very expensive. They express this Deram cohomology as some classes in Deram cohomology as linear combinations of symbols. And we need that for our computations, because we take these linear combinations of symbols in Deram cohomology, then we construct their avatars in all our cohomologies, that is Hyodokato, crystalline, logarithmic crystalline, etc. And that way we can in fact identify maps in many places, but also identify the action of Frobenius, for example. Okay, so I want to explain, so I didn't explain what the Steinbergs appearing here are. So these are generalized Steinbergs, and I just want to say what this one particular is. So for any abelian group, we take locally constant functions on G mod certain parabolic, and we are modding out functions coming from deeper level here. And the parabolic, so I didn't know how to draw a matrix in LaTeX, so I just wrote it this way. So you have one non-trivial, you have a D plus one by D plus one matrix, and you have one non-trivial block in the left upper corner of dimension D minus R minus one. So I think I got the indices right here. So some properties of this, because these are maybe not so familiar to many people, because these are p-adic, mod p or p-adic Steinbergs. So first of all, we get always a smooth G module. Also, if you work, if your A coefficient is a field, if you are in characteristic zero or P, you in fact get something irreducible. So for characteristic zero, it's a classical result. and in characteristic P is a result of Grosse Klone. And the way he proves this result is in fact the way, so many of the techniques he developed to prove this result and many others, we use these techniques to compute the cohomologies of Drinfeld symmetric spaces. So I just want to recall that actually this, if L is equal to P, so this irreducibility fails. And Vinieras gave examples of reducible representations in that case. So one more general remark is that this generalized Steinberg can be defined for any subset of the simple roots, and they define all irreducible constituents of the locally constant functions on G mod Borel with values in A. And oh, sorry, this, so maybe I need something like FP here. And with multiplicity one. So this should be specialized to the finite field. Okay, so let me stress it once more that we really essentially use the irreducibility of the Steinberg of FP in our proofs. So this is one input from representation theory we have. Okay, so let's look first at rational p-adic cohomologies of the Drinfeld space. So we claim that for proetale cohomology with QP coefficients, we have the following diagram where the rows are exact. And these are all fresher spaces now. And in fact, all the arrows have closed images. And you see here you have proetale, here you have differentials. And here you have the Steinbergs, two different Steinbergs, one with values in C and one with values in QP, both smooth. Now for the rational etale cohomology, you get a dual of continuous Steinberg here, which can be written using smooth Steinberg in this way. And the Hyodo-Kato cohomology is the dual of the smooth Steinberg with values now if F in F, which is the fraction field of the David vectors. Okay, so I want to add here some comment, but this was already computed, is not our theorem, that was computed by Grosse Klone. He computed the Frobenius and Hyodo-Kato cohomology, which he studied, computed that its action is pure, so we have slope, it acts by multiplication by PR. Of course, I mean in the semilinear way, and that the monodromy is trivial. So for the Frobenius, he uses weight spectral sequence with respect to the standard integral model, and then purity for algebraic varieties. And for monodromy, we use this equation here, and then the purity of Frobenius. And you will see immediately if you combine the two that you get the n has to be actually zero. So that's one argument to show that n is zero. And let me mention that there are actually, recently they appeared two new proofs of this computation for proetale cohomology. So one is of Sasha Orlik, who at least in principle is not using, I mean, in conceptual sketch of the argument, he's not using p-adic Hodge theory, but maybe he has to use some result along the way. And he's using his techniques for computing cohomology of period domains. And then there is a proof of Guido Bosco, which uses the different fundamental exact sequences than the ones we are using. And then he proves that the terms of these sequences, which appear, actually all satisfy homotopy property with respect to the open unit ball. So he can actually revoke the use the results of Schneider-Stuhler in his arguments. So the first paper, I think, is already out. The second paper should be out soon. Okay, so I want to give the arguments for proetale cohomology, and I want to give the arguments for computation of rational etale cohomology. And along the way, I have to actually compute integral Deram and crystalline cohomologies to do the etale cohomologies. So this is what I'm planning to sketch for you now. So as I mentioned, we have this general comparison theorem for Stein spaces in any dimension. So if we apply it here, we get this kind of diagram. So we have proetal cohomology, we have differentials, then we have this Hyodo-Kato part again, and then we have the RAM part. Okay, so now we can try to compute these things. So we are using a standard model. So we look at the standard semi-stable model of the Drinfeld half space in dimension, the Drinfeld space in dimension D. And in the first step, so recall that the RAM cohomology was computed by Schneider Stuller as the dual of this Steinberg with values in K. Then we know that we have, well, we don't necessarily, well, we don't, no, we do know in this case. We have Hyodo-Kato isomorphism between Hyodo-Kato cohomology extended to K and the RAM cohomology. And then Ayavita's piece tell us also that the RAM cohomology is generated by symbols, as I mentioned. So by linear combinations of symbols. What do I mean by symbols? So think in dimension one of something like D log of Z minus X, where Z is the variable and X is a point. And using that, you can actually understand what Frobenius does. So this is d log of z, let's say, and so the Frobenius is going to act by p in dimension r. You will have r wedge of this kind of d log. So we'll have action by p r, and on Hyodo-Kato. So we can define the same type of symbols in Hyodo-Kato. Then the action is going to be by p r. So. That allows us to compute that Hyodo-Kato cohomology is in fact also Steinberg's, but with values in F, the dual, of course. And then if we look at the PR eigenspace of this, we are going to basically get rid of this PR by looking at these symbols. And then we have just action of the natural Frobenius of F over QP. And so taking fixed points gets us the Steinberg. There should be dual, sorry, it's a typo. There should be dual here. So dual of the Steinberg with QP values. Okay, so that's the idea of the computations. And I will explain a little bit more in a moment. This computation of Ayavita's piece, that is how do we represent the RAM classes as symbols. But before that, I need to tell you about computation of integral the RAM cohomology and integral crystalline cohomology. So in this computation, we use this theorem of Grosse-Klone. So he proves acyclicity of the RAM cohomology. So you have something like a Stein property for the model, but only with respect to the RAM differentials. So hi of any differentials vanish in non-trivial degrees. But moreover, he computes that H0 can be expressed by this D log. So this is some kind of sheaf of D log forms, of log forms. And the point is that if you take a D of it, you are going to end up with zero. So H0 is killed by D. So what does it imply? It implies that for us, it means that the RAM cohomology actually of the model. So this is integral. X is the model. So the RAM cohomology of the model is just H global sections of the J differentials in degree J. So this is what we want to know. So how do you prove this kind of theorem? So the proof is kind of interesting. It's hard, actually, the proof. And first, you prove this theorem in the local setting. So you take some open sets of the generic fiber or of the model, which come from some special open sets of the fibers, and you prove acyclicity, this kind of acyclicity for this local situation. So you have that HIs of differentials vanish, and in any non-trivial degree, you are just left with H0, so with global sections. So then when you build your Czech complex associated to some covering by this kind of open sets, this Chang complex will have a combinatorics controlled by the Bruchatitz building. And on every piece, you only have this constant functions really now. So your computation is now reduced to computation of cohomology of some local system on this combinatorial object. And you have to, and it's more actually it's something like a pieces of that object. And you have to compute that, which is not so trivial either. So this is a difficult computation of Grosse-Plana, and we had to modify it a little bit for our needs. Okay, so now more explicitly, I want to make more explicit the computation here of this Deram cohomology as H0 as global sections of omega j. So we were talking about generalized, we defined this generalized Steinbergs as certain quotients, but we want to see them now, in fact, as locally constant functions on, so some kind of linear constant functions on R plus one tuples of this hyperplane, set of hyperplane sections, hyperplanes in K-rational hyperplanes in projective space. The C here, which you see, it refers to the fact that it's not the whole space of locally constant functions. It's actually, there are some relations which these functions have to satisfy, very explicit relations, which are easy enough so that actually if you work with them, you can control them. And then we look at distributions with values in K. So homes from this space of locally constant functions to K. And then we have this presentation of the dual of generalized Steinbergs. So the dual is given by the distributions here with values in K, and there is some kernel coming from these relations by which we have to model out. Okay, so this is the presentation we like. So basically what we have here, as I mentioned before, we have some linear combinations of symbols. And now the theorem, which we prove, is that you can express both the RAM classes, but also these global sections via this, well, we call it regulators, but it's a really fancy way of saying you take symbols, linear combinations of symbols. So which symbols? Here we take the RAM symbols, and here we take something like Hodge state symbols. And that when you define these regulators to Hodge state part here and to the Deram part, everything commutes. Okay, so how do you do that? So you do it in a very explicit way. First, we use Iovitash Spitz computation. So what they computed is that there's a typo, this should be a big X here. If you look at the if you look at the isomorphism here between the Deram cohomology now of the generic fiber and this dual to Steinberg, the isomorphism defined by Schneider-Stuhler, this can be actually expressed very explicitly as a regulator. So you have this regulator from distributions and to the RAM cohomology. And here you have the natural map coming from canonical map from the definition to the Steinberg, and this diagram here now commutes. So otherwise speaking, we can define the isomorphisms between the RAM cohomology and the generalized Steinberg on the generic fiber also by the RAM regulator. So what do I mean by this the RAM regulator here? We take any distribution and we integrate symbols, real symbols here, the RAM symbols with respect to this distribution. So it really is something like linear combinations of the RAM symbols. By the RAM symbols here, the following. So they are associated to R plus one hyperplanes. So we take some convenient equations here and we normalize them. And we take D logs of these equations, basically. Okay, so this gives us very nice description of the rational, simple description of the rational situation. And now in this theorem, all we have to do is to leave this to the integral situation. So we leave this to using crystalline cohomology to this integral data. And then we have to use representation theory to show, in fact, that everything is an isomorphism. So this integral computation now it gives a very nice result. So we have that the Deram cohomology of the model is expressed as the dual of this Steinberg, but with values in OK. So we get measures here. And very similar techniques show us that this crystalline Hyodokato, so it's an integral Hyodokato, so crystalline cohomology. It's also, in fact, expressible as the Steinbecks now with values in OF, so with vectors. And so this basically I just proved this statement. And the second statement I'm not going to prove, but we can deduce from that the type of homology with ZP coefficients is also isomorphic to this measure space. And so just let me mention that. So in the proof of this second statement, we use this integral computation of the RAM cohomology, and then we use the comparison theorem, which appears in the second paper, so BMS2, and then some computation, I mean, the generalization to log setup by Chesnavicius Koshikawa. So in BMS2, they have a comparison between p-adic nearby cycles and something looking like symptomatic cohomology, but it's completely integral. And so this is what we needed here. And we replace in this way the Tsuji's comparison of Tsuji between p-adic nearby cycles and symptomatic cohomology, which is integral only up to some denominators. Okay, so I don't want to talk about this. On the other hand, I would like to prove the rational version of this formula, which I stated at the beginning. I don't have much time left, so maybe I'm not going to go very far in that proof. But so let me start. So we want to compute that we have etale cohomology with QP coefficients as the dual of this continuous Steinberg with QP values. Okay, so what is the problem here? So this computation is very different from the computation you have seen for pro-etale cohomology, and it's much more delicate. And the reason for this is that we again use the first step. So we do the same step using the Tsuji's comparison between etale cohomology and symptomatic cohomology in some range. But the problem is now that we cannot get a nice expression involving Hyodokato cohomology and the RAM cohomology for this symptomatic cohomology. We are not able to do that. So instead, we just use the properties, very explicit, special properties of our scheme. For example, the fact that it's pro-ordinary in some sense, which I will explain, to try to simplify this symptomatic cohomology. So what do? We have this symptomatic cohomology, which is defined by definition, this eigenspace of crystalline cohomology, and then you go to crystalline cohomology mod some Hodge filtration level, and then you take a mapping fiber of this. This bracket just means mapping fiber. So then we apply certain, I will explain how you compute it in a moment, but you can simplify this. So what you get here is crystalline Hyodokato, tensor some period rings, AST, and then you get the RAM tensor another period ring, which is a little bit modified acris, and then you mod out by FR. And here you have map, which is mysterious map, very difficult to compute in general. So I will simplify the notation, and we call this Hyodokato part by HKR, and this DRAM part by DRR. Okay, so how do we pass from this first line to the second line, which is this tensor product, which is already a much simplified version of the first line, which seems rather mysterious. So we use Skinner formula, first of all. So what is KX bar? Did I define what I mean by X bar? I did define. So X bar is X extended, so the integral model, and then you extend coefficients to OC. So we do that here, and then I apply Kinet formula. So I have X cross OC, so I can split it if in good circumstances into the cohomology of X itself, like here and here. So here I will get the RAM, here crystalline, and then cohomology of OC. And then cohomology of OC is gives us various period rings. So I wrote here that if you take crystalline cohomology, you get acris. And so if you take other cohomology, so here's kind of like a Hyodokato type, here like a Deram-Tarp type, so here's something like a derived Deram complex, you get our period rings. So this is what we do. And now, moreover, here you, this to really split off this, because a priori here you get some crystalline cohomology only, but you want to split off this Hedokata cohomology, so then you have to use dwarf trick, which just means that you are applying Frobenius many times to split off this small part here on the left. Okay, so then we want to compute cohomology of this Hedokata part and this Deram part, which are now just some complexes. And how do and another thing I want you to notice is that Q, we inverted P only on the outside everywhere here. Okay, so we compute now cohomology of this HK. It turns out to be in degrees, just in certain degrees, so in degree R and R minus one, it has this form. We get some logarithmic Deram-Witt cohomology in degree zero of R differentials, here of R minus one differentials twisted by some period ring. And the Ram complex, in fact, splits off in this kind of very simple way. And here we use this acyclicity we proved. So we use acyclicity of the integral omega. So we don't get any higher cohomologies of omega, just H zero. That's why we get this simple expression. And then for the first two terms, we use this pro-ordinarity I mentioned. That is, if you look at the special fiber of our model, then you can express it as a limit of, so I mentioned you take all the irreducible component at the distance n to the central component, but this time you want to take them to be proper. That is, at the very end, when they intersect with the missing components, you don't extract these points, but you keep them and you put some log structure there. So you get some kind of logarithmic proper scheme, and it's ordinary. Turns out that is, if you look at its cohomology in any degrees I and j of the boundaries here, you get zero. So that's Bloch-Kato definition. And because it's ordinary, then you can get this kind of very explicit computation. Very explicit computation of the Hedokata cohomology of the model. So it, in fact, it's just H zero of this log Deram-Witt log differentials. Okay, so my watch tells me that I am finished with my time. So I would not like to extend. Maybe let me see. I have two pages left. So maybe I will continue next time. What do you think?
It's up to you.
Because I mean, it's up to you really, because I can do both.
Do you think you will have enough time for tomorrow's lecture if you leave it for?
I think I will, yes.
Okay, well then maybe we can leave it for tomorrow then. Yeah, so let's thank the speaker again then.